Baptist. You're in for a blessing tonight. We certainly welcome all those tuning in from live stream, and we've got a wonderful group of believers here in the audience tonight, so you're prepared for a blessing. We're going to start with some songs to prepare our hearts for the preaching, and Jonathan is already. He is standing up. Y'all follow Jonathan's lead back there and stand up. Stand up for Jesus. John, you are setting a good example tonight. Amen. Let's sing page 188 or look at the screens. At the cross, and let's do the first, second, and the last.
Alas, did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for sinners such as
I? That's not KJV.
At the cross, where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for Christ that I alone? He groaned upon the tree.
I'll catch up.
Amazing pity, grace alone, and love beyond me.
I know this part.
At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
But drops of grief
can never repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do.
At the cross,
where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Brother Andrew comes to lead us in prayer. We want to thank you for all the great results and responses to this morning's service. We had a great turnout and great preaching of the Word of God, and so we enjoyed you being here. Brother Andrew, you come open us in prayer.
Thank you. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you this night, Lord, just thankful to be in your house, Lord. We thank you so much that you continue to move in this church, that you continue to move in this community.
Yes.
I just pray that you be with us tonight, Lord. Just open our hearts, soften our hearts to receive this message that Dr. Ball is about to give. And please, Lord, anoint his lips to give that message that you know we need to hear tonight, Lord. I just ask that you continue to grow this church spiritually and just help us to be stronger in faith, Lord. And I hope that we can honor you for that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Andrew. Continue to stand. Follow Jonathan's example back there. Let's sing 192, The Blood Will Never Lose Its Power. Before we start, remember this is our fellowship song. And let us know out there in the live stream that you're listening. Send us thumbs up. Y'all did great this morning, letting us know that you were certainly tuning in. And this evening, if you still have tithes or offerings, our tithing stations are available. Certainly make use of them. And again, let us know by waving at each other and giving a great sound sign of fellowship. The blood will never lose its power. Amen.
The blood that Jesus shed for me, way back on Calvary, the blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power. For it reaches to the highest mountain,
yes it does,
and it goes to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never.
It soothes my doubts.
It soothes my doubts and calms my fears. And it dries all my tears, the blood that gives me strength. From day to day, it will never lose.
Oh, sing it out, church.
For he reaches to the highest mountain.
Yes, it does.
And it flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day to day, it will never lose its power.
And all God's people said, amen.
Thank you. Be seated, please. And again, it is so good to see all of you out tonight.
Yeah.
This is the first time we have had an official in-person Sunday night service since March 11th was the last time we met together officially in person on Sunday night. Though we have, when we have been over in the annex, we have had small crowds every, usually about 10 or 15, but we're so glad you came tonight. And I told Dr. Brown, I said, this is such a good crowd, you're preaching Sunday night the rest of the year. So, he said he might not be here every Sunday night, but we're excited to have Dr. Ball, and we'll bring him up here in just a moment. I just want to remind you of a few announcements very quickly here. We mentioned all these this morning, but we want to remind you, first of all, about our Faith Bible Institute that has started.
Man.
And Brother Butch was telling me, I think he said they have 16 students this year. And for those of you who are not familiar with it, it is a three-year course. And it's a little bit intense because there are actually colleges that will give you college credit if you take the course. But it is excellent. It goes through the entire Bible, including doctrine, from a good, solid biblical standpoint. We also want to remind you that next Sunday night, it is Labor Day weekend, and we're not going to have an evening service next Sunday night. That's going to be the only one. We also want you to continue to be in prayer for our Wednesday evening decisions. As most of you know, Cleveland Independent School District starts tomorrow, and I know just about everybody's excited about that. Let me tell you how weird things are. I've met kids who are excited about it. That's how weird things are this year. They're actually kids excited about going to school. But we want you to pray for them, and again, some of the other school districts around here have already started. Keep them in your prayers, and as I said to you this morning, I would tentatively like to start our Wednesday evening sometime in October. Just want to see how everything fleshes out for the next month, but we would love to do that, and then prayerfully after that, about the only thing that would be left is starting up our choir again. So choir members, get it in the back of your head. We're going to have a choir again one day, all right? And we really, really look forward to that. We again want to mention some names on our prayer list. Continue to pray for the Larry Mullins family. Again, he passed away Friday. Visitation is Tuesday night, 6 to 8 at Crozier Pierce in Cleveland. And then the funeral service is Wednesday at 10 a.m. at Rose Hill. It's going to be a graveside. Also continue to pray for Brother James Scarver as he is in Heritage Trails, and hospice has been called in for him. And again, just a lot of folks that need prayer. We didn't mention this morning that missionary Russell Brinkley, his cancer surgery has been changed to September 16th. So he was originally scheduled August 10th. They moved it back about 5 weeks, so he still has his surgery coming up. And also, David Luce will be having a stress test tomorrow. He's been having some chest pains and visited his cardiologist. So please remember Brother Dave. And again, we just encourage you, pick up our bulletin, get the back of the prayer list here. Also, again, please continue to pray for Miss Margie Craig. She is in a assisted living in Crowley. She fell and hit her head, had to go to the hospital. But she is better back at the assisted living home. And I have exciting news that many of you remember the missionary we had here probably about 8 or 10 weeks back, might have been longer than that, Jonathan Apare from the Philippines. He's actually home. And I'm just going to share this real quick. He was scheduled to leave on a flight to go back to the Philippines, about March 15th. Didn't make it, got stuck here. Had just been trying to find churches to preach in. Finally got a flight back in July. He flew to LAX, everything fine, flew to the Philippines, got to the Philippines, took the COVID test, and he had COVID. So they had to quarantine 14 days. Here he is this far from home, and they had to quarantine. So he got quarantined 14 days. Then he got on a boat because his island is 36 hours away from the main island there in the Philippines. Went 36 hours, got to his island, and they said, "We're going to be careful. We're going to quarantine you 2 more weeks." So he eventually got home, but just to share this with you, and you can do with it what you like. He said that during all this time, he had to pay for his own lodging, for his own meals, and so his bill just went through the ceiling during this time. And certainly, if you would like to help with that, we would pass that along to him. But again, so good to see all of you back tonight. And again, next Sunday night, no Sunday night, but then we will just continue this from here on out. Brother Eddie.
Yes, I got to be good friends with Brother Jonathan Apare. He helped us during our vacation Bible school. And he said, "Can I speak one night?" I said, "Sure." So you can go back and review those tapes. You'll get to see him in action. But it was about Big Fish Bay was the theme of our VBS. And he says, "There's no bigger bay than the Philippines." Amen. And so he gave a great illustration of what God could do there. And we've grown to be close friends over Facebook. So you do pray for Brother Jonathan. He's a good man. Also, one other announcement. Our wings, this is our ladies' ministry. They chose Isaiah 40, verse 3 as their foundational verse. They're going to have resume their ladies' luncheon on Thursday, August 17th. This is over at Sister Pat Stevens. I wave, Mrs. Pat. Okay.
September 17th.
It says August, so it must be September. Okay, sorry. We'll correct that. September 17th. Me and Miss Pat, we both have brain disorders here. But 408 Preston Drive, 11:30 a.m. And she'll share the details later. But that is, yes, September the 17th, resuming the ladies' luncheon. So keep those ladies and women in your prayers. Let's stand again over the audience. Y'all are singing well tonight. And let's sing page 339, "Since I Have Been Redeemed." Sing it out.
I have a song I love to sing, since I have been redeemed of my Redeemer, Savior, King. Since I have been redeemed, since I have been redeemed, I will glory in His name. Since I will glory in my Savior's name. I have a Christ who satisfies, since I have been redeemed. To do His will, my highest prize, since I have been redeemed.
Lift it up.
Since I have been redeemed, I will glory in His name. My Savior's name. I have a home prepared for me, since I have been redeemed. Where I shall dwell eternally, since I have been redeemed.
Lift it up.
Since I have been redeemed, I will glory in His name.
start our, again, worship and song by singing page 335, great song of the faith, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things on earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Once more, you're sounding good tonight.
Oh, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Again, want to remind you of our usual addresses and everything. Our church address is 700 Woodard Avenue. And of course, if you want to give online, calvarycleveland.com. And there's a tab there where you can give. And our email address is, again, calvarypraise@gmail.com. Cleveland Praise@gmail.com. If you have a prayer request, cbccleveland@gmail. That is our regular email address. And our phone number is 817-645-7758, but all of you pretty well know that. Well, in just a moment, we're going to have Dr. Caldwell come and preach for us, and he is going to be a blessing. We always enjoy having him, and I appreciate this man so much. Usually when we have a guest speaker, I don't do a lot of talking about the man, but Dr. Ball has meant so much to me. There is a spiritual gift in the Bible that's mentioned, and it's the spiritual gift of exhortation or encouragement. Amen. And I want to tell you that Dr. Carl Ball has the spiritual gift of encouragement.
Amen.
I've never been around him where he has not been smiling and upbeat. And I want to tell you this, not every bit of ministry is all smiling and upbeat, I promise you. But every time I've been around him, he has been a personal encourager to me, and he has encouraged me in times when he didn't even know I needed it. And he has been such a blessing to this church. One of the highlights of my life, and I know I'm going to do it at least one more time maybe, was actually going up and digging dinosaur bones with him in Colorado. And I know many of our church members have done that. We've had probably about 8 to 10 different church members who have gone up to dig dinosaur bones. I'm going to tell you, by the way, if you picture fascinating, it's really not, okay? It's with a little spoon digging dirt out. If you think, you know, tractors and shovels, because you'll damage the bones. But you know, that's one of the things. It's like, if I had a bucket list, digging dinosaur bones would be on it, and I've already checked that one off. But a couple of years ago, Betty and I went up there, just a wonderful time, and then some of our other church members went up there, and there was a big fire, and they all escaped, and we're thrilled with that. But before I went up there, he asked me if there was a song that I could work on singing, and I'd heard it just a couple of times before, but I want to sing it right before he comes, and as soon as I'm done, Dr. Ball, you just come right up and start preaching. This simply is entitled, How Big Is God?
Skies, but a
portion of his yard. As winter's chill may cause the tiny seed to fall and lie asleep to wait by heaven's rain, the heart grown cold will warm and trod with life anew. The master's touch will bring the glow again. How big is God? How big and wide his vast domain? To try to tell, these lips can only start. He's big enough to rule his mighty universe, yet small enough to live within my heart. He's big enough to rule his mighty universe, yet small enough to live within my heart. How big is God? How big is God? How big is God?
I love you, Pastor. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Don't you appreciate, one of the deacons told me shortly after we called the pastor, he said, we got all of that package in one. Not just a preacher, a leader, a teacher, a pastor, but a tremendous, tremendous vocalist. Let's give him another hand of deep love and appreciation. We are embroiled in a battle. We're all aware of a condition that presents an invisible enemy. We could say 86 years ago, there was a new nation born, but instead of that, we are possibly facing the demise of the greatest nation on the face of the earth, the most powerful nation on the face of the earth today. And I'm not a pessimist, I'm a realist. Pastor, I respect this pulpit. It's the sacred desk of God.
Amen.
Behind this pulpit have stood over the years some of God's choice servants. I remember Homer Ritchie preaching a series of meetings, standing behind this pulpit. Now, Brother Ritchie and I went back a long way. You probably don't, did you? You did know Homer Ritchie. Who didn't know Homer Ritchie? Longtime pastor, First Baptist Church in Fort Worth, Texas. Some years ago, he told me personally, he said, I got a letter this week. I had him at one of the churches that I pastored. He said, I got a letter this week. It was simply addressed, Homer Ritchie, Fort Worth, Texas. Now, I doubt if that would work in Glen Rose just by name delivered at our little town of 2,000 people. That's how well-known, how dynamic, how well-respected he was. Homer Ritchie stood in this pulpit, and he said, for the information of those who may not be Bible scholars and theologians, It is doubtful that the United States is listed directly in prophecy. Now, first of all, I want to tell you, I'm a patriot. I'm a red-blooded American. When I wear a mask, it's red, white, and blue. And I'm not announcing the demise of the United States of America. But Homer Ritchie said, the United States is not the focal point of prophecy. Israel is. And the nations surrounding Israel constitute the basic emphasis in their relationship with Israel in the prophecy and the forecast of the Bible. And he's right. He said, I don't know what's going to happen to the United States, and neither do I. He said, it's possible that there will be a nuclear war, and we will be essentially annihilated. I hope that's not the case. He said, it is possible that there will be a rupture again of the great cauldron that we have in the Northwest. And of course, you know that beautiful Yellowstone Park. According to evolutionary history, and you can just wipe the word evolution out and the dates out, but 160,000 years ago, that cauldron was formed as there was a tremendous eruption, and there is a cauldron boiling underneath Yellowstone National Park. And 160,000 years ago, according to evolutionary reckoning, and you can just strike that figure, but at that time there was a huge explosion, and the ash from the explosion of the cauldron, producing the cauldron of Yellowstone National Park, extended for 1,400 miles and in points was 11 feet thick. They can still measure the amount of dust that was expunged from Yellowstone National Park. And he said, and there was a documentary presented a few years ago by the British stating that inevitably it will occur. We don't know when, but it could occur very soon because there are writhings underneath, according to this documentary. And if it does, the ash will settle not only 1,400 miles away, it would extend all the way to New York City and will cover New York City a few feet in ash. It'll extend all the way to Miami, and just we happen to be between the cauldron and Miami. And so literally scholars are wondering if that might be the demise, and theologians are wondering if that might be the demise of the United States of America. I'm not forecasting the demise of the United States of America. And then Dr. Ritchie said, it is possible that the moral decay that is already written in the fullness of the Gentiles, exercised because we export everything we have, our morals. And there was a time when our soldiers after World War I, are you listening? After World War I, our soldiers exported the gospel to the nations we conquered. That's the kind of moral fiber we had back in the 1940s and 1950s. But that moral fiber is gone. So Homer Ritchie said, it is possible from this pulpit, it is possible that the moral decay will finally catch up and we will literally find ourselves like leprosy, eaten from within and destroyed with our influence globally.
That's right.
Now, I'm a patriotic American, but I do realize that we have forgotten the crib from which we were fed. We have forgotten the Lord who created us. The official academic position at our academic institutions, and many of these are in seminaries, and many of these, most of the credentialed universities of America that hold Christian names hold to an atheistic evolutionary position, and some of them will not let you have a degree, earn a degree, no matter what your class grades are, will not let you earn a degree, a certified degree, unless you adopt, at least on paper, the theory of evolution, which is naturalistic and atheistic. These are difficult times. It might be that an invisible enemy will take its toll and we will not be able to function. Brother Donnie, you know, fortunately, the last few weeks I've been able to be here, and I'll be gone next Sunday, But then I'll be able to be here for a few weeks, a couple of weeks after that. I'm going to be in Missouri. I'll be speaking, but I'll also be visiting my fourth great-grandchild. So that is excused, right? That is legitimate. So I'm going to be gone a few times here and there. But I love hearing Brother Monk preach. I love hearing him sing. I love hearing our teachers teach. Brother Donnie, the last few weeks, has emphasized his concern that many of our good people fall prey to the habit of not being in the Lord's house because we were instructed not to be in the Lord's house. And we do follow, as Peter said, we obey all the regulations of the magistrates. We wear a mask when it's proper and appropriate. Pretty hard to talk in it from the pulpit. But we wear a mask when it's appropriate. And we do have an invisible enemy. I have a daughter who has a PhD in microbiology, and she tells me, Dad, it's real. It's been overemphasized. It's been underemphasized. It's been politicized. It has been polarized. It's been exaggerated. It's been diminished. It's been used for political reasons and personal reasons, but there is an enemy out there, and it is genuine. During the election this year, there are possibilities that certain forces will take hold of the United States, determined to destroy the economy of our country by having us be paranoid about this invisible enemy. Let's not be paranoid. Let's be realistic. But let's not stop living. Let's not stop doing the good we can do, and especially preaching the gospel of the Word of God.
Amen.
My great concern is, the scripture teaches theologically, and I will close on time, Pastor. I may never get to the message because there's so much to talk about. The scriptures are very clear that our Lord is coming.
Amen.
And the signs have to do with the return of Christ to rule and reign. Did you realize that? There are no signs for the rapture. The rapture is going to be like a thief in the night. And I've been so encouraged with these messages. And tonight's message is to simply say amen to what our pastor has been preaching these last couple of months on the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit will be taken out of the way. That is, his influence will be restrained. Now, God is everywhere. How big is God? He's big enough to rule his mighty universe, yet small enough to live within my heart. Preacher, would you sing that again when I come back after a couple of weeks? How many were blessed tonight?
Amen.
It's been worth all the effort taken to get here already. The Holy Spirit's restraint is going to be realized. And as we've learned in our Sunday school lessons, the Holy Spirit lives within us. And to the degree that we are restrained, the Holy Spirit's ministry is restrained. Now, he's bigger than all of us, but it just so happens that he resides within us as the temple of the Holy Spirit of God. How big is this issue? I'm thrilled with this crowd tonight. I'm thrilled with the crowds that we have on Sunday morning, Sunday school and morning service. But I remember when you were praying about a new facility because you were packed out in both services. And it is genuine that many people fall out of the habit of regularly being in the Lord's house, and to some degree fall out of the habit of publicly representing our Lord Jesus Christ. Let me give you an illustration. One of the friends of mine that I treasured over a period of years was Art Rohrheim. That name may not mean anything to you. Pastor, you probably know the name.
Yeah.
Well, Art Rohrheim established Awana. He established it in a storefront building downtown Chicago, Illinois. I've been to that building. The last 10 years, that great church in Chicago, Quinton Road Baptist Church, has flown me up to speak for them at the national conference. And after that final message, then they held a banquet, and Art Rohrheim was at the speaker's table. Dr. Scudder was at the speaker's table, and because I had just preached, they let me sit at the speaker's table. That's pretty good. You don't need to know everything. You just need to run with those who do. And I mean, year after year, I would say, Dr. Rohrheim, I'm not Doc, call me Art. Okay. Art, how's it going? And he would spell out what's going on. How many do you have internationally attending weekly sessions of Awana? Now, you know what Awana is, right? Three of you know. It's a literal training of young people. They get the gospel, they get a message, they get an opportunity to respond to that message. They get the basic training, like you do in Bible college or seminary, but they get the children's form of that. And then they have activities. They wear jackets. Brother Donnie, do you still have your jacket? Do you ever wear it? Oh, you graduated from Awana. Okay. I asked him, I said, Art, how many do you have regularly in these sessions, little churches, great churches, small halls, campsite, weekly Awana meetings? And he said, the latest count is between 3 and 4 million children at Awana every single week. And I asked him, how many of those received Christ during that training program, during the exercises, during the excitement of that children's, it's just a fantastic evangelistic biblical instruction procedure. How many of those, as a rule, actually find Christ as a result of that work? And he said, at least 3 out of 4 get saved in that program.
Amen. Wow.
You understand what I'm saying? I'm saying because of the pandemic or our response to the pandemic, I'm saying that as a result, those meetings are temporarily put on hold. I wonder during these months how many children, how many young people will not trust Christ from this human standpoint, because we are responsible to witness to everyone we can. How many will be left out? How many will not be having the Holy Spirit of God live within them? To what degree will the Holy Spirit's influence be diminished just within the 6 months or so that we have been exercised by COVID-19? It's a realistic thing. How big is God? Hopefully I can get the message in tonight. Looking across the centuries, I think we're at the threshold of God exercising, laying bare his mighty arm, to use a scriptural phrase. We're at the threshold of God doing a marvelous and a mighty thing. Are you awake?
Amen.
Now, two or three of you, are you awake?
Amen.
Good, that woke up the rest of us. Now, how do we get through this on a practical basis? In a moment, I'm going to try to encourage you scripturally, biblically, theologically. But on a practical basis, how do we keep encouraged? How do we fight the battle? Now, I want to give you a few tips from an old soldier who's been through quite a few skirmishes. I've been through quite a few wars. I've been young and now I'm old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken nor his seed begging bread. And here we stand. Would you like two or three tips on how to get through these battles?
Amen.
Number one, don't fight the battle yourself. You'll lose. Early in life, God taught me some lessons before I was saved, and God foreknew that I would trust Jesus Christ, and those influences would carry for a lifetime. I'll mention but two of them. I remember I was about 6 and a half years of age, summertime, scrawny, dirty kid, barefoot, Saturday. I went to Dad and I said, Dad, I'm hungry for an ice cream. And Belinda, I'm hungry for bedrock ice cream in Dinosaur, Colorado. Did you have some ice cream when you were there? Yes. Are you coming back for the ice cream? I was about 6.5 years of age. Remember it as vividly as if it were now. It was summertime like this. San Antonio, it was hot like this. Daddy, I'm hungry for ice cream. Well, son, I don't have any money. I said, well, an ice cream cone down at the drugstore cost a dime for a single dip. Daddy looked in his pocket. I'm so glad we grew up poor. I know how to appreciate a bologna sandwich and an ice cream cone. He had 4 pennies. That was all. 4 pennies. He said, I don't have enough. He said, why don't you do this, son? Take these 4 pennies and go to the drugstore and just say, I want half. I've got 4 pennies. I want half an ice cream cone. Oh man, anything. That was encouraging. I held those 4 pennies in my grungy, dirty little hand. I mean, you know, kids, summertime, don't wash like they should. Nowadays, my wife says I don't wash like I should. But I held those 4, that was solid gold. It was half a mile to the drugstore. I could trace every step. Got to the drugstore, and there was a teenage girl, very kind looking, behind the counter, and her boss was on a higher counter above. And I said, ma'am, I was always taught to be respectful, ma'am, an ice cream cone is a dime. Yes. I said, I don't have a dime. I have 4 pennies. Will you sell me half an ice cream cone? She glanced up, I can see her at this moment, glanced up behind her to her boss on a higher counter. He nodded. I held my pennies. She took that ice cream cone. She reached in, strawberry. Reached in, got a big dip. I thought, you're gonna give me that whole dip? And she crammed it and crammed it, and I thought she had never stopped cramming that thing in that cone. She crammed it in that cone. Then she glanced up at her boss and she reached down, got another dip, crammed it on top of that until it wasn't going to fall off. I can see her now reaching across the counter. And I reluctantly gave her my 4 pennies. I took my ice cream cone with both hands. She was grinning. Her boss was grinning. I was grinning. I walked out of that store, and I was eating my strawberry double-dip ice cream cone. And you know what? That has influenced me for a lifetime. She gave, and he gave, what I didn't deserve. Every chance I get, I just try to do something good for somebody who can't pay me back. Isn't it good to do something not expecting anything in return? You know, we have folks here that not only are loyal and faithful and tithers and givers and workers, but we've got a ministry in Glenrose, and we just signed a 30-year lease on property there to dig, but the grounds were scrounging. And there are 3 men who park themselves every Sunday right over here. And they make sure that those grounds are mowed. And they make sure that when I get back in town, it looks like somebody lives there and it looks like we have a ministry going. They must have eaten the same ice cream cone. Did you, Elvis? What about like that? Somebody did something for us we could not pay for, and we just keep giving. Let me give you another illustration. Don't fight your own battles. Time went by. I was about 8.5 or 9. San Antonio, late summer, cool spell blew in. and school hadn't started, but there was a fair on the school grounds. I had a buddy, I was about 8 and a half, maybe 9. I had a buddy who was about 14. He had 2 older brothers. His father owned the tavern half block away. That's the kind of neighborhood we lived in. His father owned the tavern, but his mother was a Christian. And she made sure that her boys didn't cuss, didn't smoke, didn't drink, even though their dad owned and ran the tavern, didn't drink, and were respectful. Well, those older boys taught their 14-year-old younger brother how to defend himself in case he ever got in a battle, in a fight. His name was Billy Hart. I was about 8 and a half or 9. He was my buddy. He said to me, "You know, they got a fair up at the school. Let's go up there tonight." "All right." He had a little jacket. I didn't have a jacket to my name. "So, Mother, do you mind if we go up to the fair?" She said, "Just don't get in any trouble." All right. Went to the fair, enjoyed ourselves, started back. It was about 2 miles in South San Antonio back home. About halfway, there was a barricade in the little lane leading to the main street. 4 bully teenage street fighters were standing in our way. And we started through, and they pushed us back. They said, "We want to fight you two." My goodness, these were street fighters. They fought dirty. My heart was racing. We tried again. They pushed us back. "We want to fight you two." And they were dead serious. I looked up, and Billy Joe Hart said, "You don't need to fight. Hold my jacket." I took his jacket. He rolled up his sleeves, walked right in the middle of those guys. He had moves I never dreamed. Karate Kid wouldn't know how to do what. I mean, upper jaw, everything. In about 3 minutes, 2 of them lay in the dirt, and the other 2 were running down the alley. He walked back, smiled, and I gave him his jacket. I said, "Billy Joe, your hand's bleeding." He said, "Yeah, I hit one of them too hard." You know something? The work that I do attracts the attention of Satan himself. One of ICR's best scientists was there at the museum 2 days ago with his wife. And they said, "We're so grateful for the work you do that we're not doing. We work in other areas academically, but the areas we work in at the museum is what the evolutionists despise of all the evidence in the world." So they curse my name. They use language. How would you like for your kid to come home from school and say, "Dad, did you know that our teacher read an article to us today that was written about you, and it was dirty?" How would you like to live with that? How would you like to have a fight, a new battle, every time you face a new audience, a new church, every time I walk in? Sooner or later, after 15 or 20 minutes, someone will walk up and say, "You know, I was reading something the other day on the web about you," and oh no, here it comes again. Sometimes Satan himself opposes directly. But you know something? I've learned a secret. I don't have a single scar. I don't fight my own battles.
Amen.
A lot of people pray to Satan, and they say, "Now, Satan, you've been around too long," but you know, that's giving Satan room. The Bible says, "Give none occasion to the flesh and no room to Satan himself." I don't pray to Satan. You know what I do when Satan accosts me? And by the way, There's a committee called the Committee of Correspondents dedicated to oppose everything I do in the press and in private correspondence, a literal committee that is commissioned to do that internationally. And there is a committee of minions straight from hell itself that carries that out and opposes me every day of my life. So what do? Every day I get approached by those minions or by Satan. What do? I just turn to my Savior and say, Lord Jesus, would you take care of them? And he does. And instantly, the moment I mention his name, they flee, because the battle is already won. So here's some advice from an old soldier, and I will get to the message and I'll finish on time. Here's some advice from an old soldier how to get through the battle. Number one, don't fight your own battles. Let Jesus do it for you. If you get in the midst of the battle, you'll have a lot of scars. Jesus already bears the scar. Number one, don't fight your own battles. Number two, fellowship with God's people. They spake often one to another. There was no open vision. They spake often one to another. Fellowship with God's people. In the cold of the Northeast, I lived there a number of years, and in the fireplaces we had, if you had a coal left by itself, around midnight, it would turn cold. But if you put all the coals together, the next morning you rake it a little bit, and the fires, the embers are still burning. Fellowship with God's people, that's number two. Number one, don't fight your own battles. Number two, fellowship with God's people. Number three, laugh as much as you can. It is good to laugh. Every once in a while, we need a deep belly laugh. Last night, Bob Summers is a dear buddy of mine. You know who Bob Summers is, the world famous artist who sculpted the John Wayne, the Byron Nelson, the Trail Drive, all of those things. He lives in Glen Rose, and I teach a class in his home every other week and a half for almost 40 years. Bob Summers, tomorrow morning at 5:30, will have hip replacement. So I called him yesterday and I said, you need a steak. I didn't really have the money for a steak, but I saved up my money. And he said, well, I could use the energy. I said, I'll pick you up at 4:30 after I close the museum. Picked him up at 4:30. And my wife said, now don't buy him dessert. I think she was saying, you don't have enough money to buy the steak as it is. Don't buy him dessert. I said, why not, sweetheart? She said, because I have dessert for him. Well, what do you have? Well, she said, I bought some cheese streusels at Brookshire's, and I've got enough for him and his family, so I have dessert. Just come by and get it. All right. So we went out, had a nice steak. I don't eat steak a lot. It cost a lot of money, but I enjoyed every bit of it, and I enjoyed watching him get the energy. And he needed the energy, and all God's people said,
amen.
That's justification for buying a steak. So we ate. I came back. We laughed, had a good time. Picked up. We went by and picked up the dessert. I dropped him by his place, dessert and all. And I went back to the house. I walked in and I said to my wife, sweetheart, Bob was really disappointed in that dessert. What do you mean? He didn't like it? Well, I'm sure. Well, I guess he liked it. But I told Bob that you had found your grandmother's old recipe for cheese streusel, and it required a hot stove, and you labored for hours making that dessert for him, and when you dropped that dessert off, it was packaged. And it was obvious that it was a counterfeit. He expected a brown bag with an old-fashioned dessert that your grandmother had the recipe for. And for a minute, my wife blinked, and then she started laughing. And I told Bob that I was going to do that, and he started laughing. Every once in a while, you just need to laugh.
Amen.
Laugh as often as you can. Now let's get to the message. Okay. All of that is just a little encouragement. Do you know God is big?
Amen.
Do you know that soon he's about to lay bare his mighty arm and demonstrate not only to the United States that has a deep cancer, a moral cancer, a spiritual depravity? Our nation's in trouble. Our world's in trouble. Might as well tell it like it is. Only God can get us out of this. The times of the Gentiles are being fulfilled, and the Gentile mindset is just about at ripening stage. Something's about to happen. How soon? I don't know. The signs to that, the pastor is preaching these messages, and I'm simply here saying amen to these messages. The signs do not have to do with the rapture, even though I'm going to talk about the rapture tonight. The signs have to do with his second coming to straighten everything out, to rule, and to reign. So the rapture has no signs, but whatever signs are now in the offing for us to see, those signs are 7 years in the making. And if we see the signs now, we know that his coming is nigh, even at the door, even the thief in the night. Are you ready for Jesus to come? Well, let's start with two passages, and then I'll give you just some basic concepts. Hopefully that will encourage you to say that God is in absolute control. He's not lost control, even though we have lost control. How many of you know how to straighten out the government in Washington? Raise your hand. How many know how to straighten out Austin? Anybody here know how to straighten out things around Cleveland? We don't have answers. This additional observation. I just got back from Colorado. We held a service near dinosaur bones. That was amazing when you were saying how big is God with dinosaur bones stacked not too far from you. That's the first time you've ever done that, right? I bet not too many people in the world have ever done that. We always hold a service there somewhere in the vicinity of the dinosaur bones and give the Lord full honor and credit for everything. Belinda Lacoste owns that property there. We always hold a service on Sunday morning, right, Belinda? So glad you came out of the wicked city of Dallas and Fort Worth and came down to the wicked city of Cleburne. Glad you're here tonight. She's our friend. She's been so kind to us. Now, as you approach Colorado, you see a grand scheme of mountains in the background. What a gorgeous array. What a grandeur of landscape. And it's a giant mountain. But then you get a little closer and you go across Eisenhower Pass, and that's about 11,000 feet, and that's a mountain. And then you dip down, and then you go down to 6,000 feet, and that's a valley. And then you go up to it. Wow, that's two mountains. And the various peaks among those mountains where you can emphasize various characteristics and things. I talked about this in Sunday school not long ago, but I want to emphasize it tonight. From a distance, it looks like one grand landscape. But when you approach it more closely, vividly, particularly, personally, you get a feeling of individual things going on. So it is with the coming of Jesus Christ. From the Old Testament, the two are viewed. His first coming, called his first advent, to be born in Bethlehem, and all of that's forecast. And then his coming in the secret rapture, and then his coming to rule and reign, and finally his coming to establish an entire new universe. All of that in one grand scheme. But as time progresses, the New Testament unfolds, history unfolds, you see various activities there. So turn in your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 26. In Isaiah 26, we see much of this in a scheme from a distance. Hundreds of passages could be used, but this is a passage not often used, and I want to emphasize it tonight. Isaiah chapter 26, verse number 19. speaking of the future when God lays bare his mighty arm and shows how big he really is in absolute majestic control of the earth, its history, and the entire universe. Verse 19, "Thy," the prophet said, "thy dead men shall live, together with my dead body." Shades of Job. I'll die. Worms will destroy my skin. Yet in my flesh after that, I shall see God. So here we have the grand scheme of the future. Thy dead men shall live, together with my dead body shall they arise, shades of rapture. Awake and sing, ye that dwell in dust, for thy dew is as the dew of herbs, it'll live again, and the earth shall cast out the dead. Wow, longing for the rapture. Come, my people, enter thou into thy chambers, underscore that for a moment, into thy chambers, and shut thy doors about thee. Hide thyself, as it were, for a little moment, underscore a little moment, a short time, until the indignation be overpassed. Wow, underscore indignation, another word for tribulation. For behold, the Lord cometh out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth. For their iniquity, the earth also shall disclose thy blood and shall no more cover her slain. Wow, God's going to rule and establish to the righteous justice and judgment forever, and he's going to straighten everything out. In the New Testament, turn please to the book of Titus. Two short verses. Titus chapter 2, verse 11. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared unto all men. Skip down to verse number 13. Looking for the blessed hope, underscore that.
Amen.
And the glorious appearing, underscore that, of the great God, underscore that, and our Savior, that's apposition, meaning the same thing, our Savior, Jesus Christ. All of those are in focus in one grand scheme. Let me just talk to you for just a few minutes. In Sunday school, a few weeks ago, Brother Donnie asked me to teach, and I gave a short lesson on the reasons for the rapture. And because Brother Donnie didn't take all of that down, I want to give him a second chance. So I want to give you, I think this audience needs to know, because this stirs me just to contemplate it. I want to give you in the next 15, 18 minutes, and we can do it and stay right on time. I want to give you seven reasons for the rapture. Number one, the first reason for the rapture is that Jesus always keeps his promise. That is amazingly awesome. He said in John chapter 14, "And if I go and prepare, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. And I've built every one of them." I mean, that's in the parentheses. He built every one of them. "In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest. How can we know the way? And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me." Number one, the first reason for the rapture is Jesus said, I'm going to do it, and he always keeps his word. How's he going to do it? The pastor this morning quoted 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13. "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren. God doesn't want us to be uninformed concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again," and we do believe that Jesus died and rose again,
amen,
"and all the church said,
amen.
Amen. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him." He will come back with them. Not time to discuss that theologically, but the scripture is very clear. "For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord." By the word of the Lord. By the word of the Lord. You know what that means?
Amen.
God said it, that settles it.
Amen.
You can put it down. It's going to happen. Now, there are a lot of theologians, there are a lot of denominations that do not emphasize the rapture, and many of them literally preach against the rapture. How can you preach against something that is so boldly, clearly delineated, spelled out in the Word of God? Well, it just doesn't fit their scheme of theology. Well, so what? We believe the book.
Amen. Yeah.
This we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not precede or prevent those which are asleep. For as for the Lord himself. Oh, I like that. Amen. Now, Gabriel's going to have a part. He's going to perhaps play a trumpet. He's good at that. He's going to have a part. But oh, God's not going to send an archangel, a committee to come get us. For the Lord himself,
amen,
the same one we saw in like manner ascend to glory, he will descend. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Why? They got 6 feet further to go. That's what D.L. Moody said. Now, soul and spirit are already with the Lord. Now, are you still awake?
Amen.
To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord.
That's right.
I can hardly wait for that. I can hardly wait to be with the Lord. I've lived 83 years, and I don't have a single scar from a battle. I got a lot of scars of my making.
Yeah.
You know why I don't have any battle scars? Jesus fights every one of my battles for me. He's already conquered every last one of them. And when I just look and say, Lord Jesus, would you take care of, they're gone. At his name, they flee. You ought to try it. He doesn't like you either, by the way. You ought to try it. But the Lord, him, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Their bodies are resting. How's God going to assimilate all of those decaying, rotting bodies? I don't know, but how big is God? Big enough to rule his mighty universe. He knows where every speck of dust, every atom, and every element is and has been for since the foundation of the world. How big is God? He's big enough to raise the dead. The dead in Christ, their bodies are asleep, but I don't think, let me talk to you just a moment. I think at death, physical death, Jesus not only will keep his promise in the rapture, but at the death of every one of his saints, he personally takes us home. I'm not expecting to even lose consciousness. Just, well, this is a problem. Hello, Lord. Just like that. Home is over there. So, our bodies will be resting, but we will never skip a beat. We'll be alive forevermore. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. All right, number one. The first reason for the rapture is Jesus always keeps his word, and he promised he's coming for us, and he's going to. Number two. Second reason for the rapture is Jesus is going to take his bride home. Home is over there. John chapter 3. John is called the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoices greatly of the bridegroom's voice, that my joy thereof may be fulfilled. We are the bride of Christ, born again, bought with his blood. The earnest of the Spirit lives within. We have a ring of commitment. We have literally been united with Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 5 reads, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Number two, to take his bride home. Number three, to deliver us from the wrath to come. Church, I meant to spend about 10 minutes on this, but let me spend just a minute and a half on this. Do you know that someday God's going to say, I've had enough? He did in the past. The pre-deluge, the pre-flood civilization got to the point where every imagination of the thoughts of the hearts of man was only evil continually. And God said, I've had enough. And the destruction not only involved human beings who didn't exercise faith and get in the boat, and that boat represented Jesus Christ, the ark, but in addition to that, all of the creation was decimated. Billions of fishes in the British Isles. That's just one illustration, all as a result of our sin. We did it. The scripture says in 1 Thessalonians 1:10, to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he hath raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. There is the wrath of a lamb. And let me just read another passage for you right quickly. Revelation 6:16. And they said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the lamb. Pause a moment. Wait a minute. The civilizations of the world, choosing wickedness deliberately, rejecting Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, deliberately, have come to their wits' end, and they will be crying for the mountains to fall on them. But God won't let it happen. Deliver us from the wrath of the Lamb. How do they know? Oh, think with me for just a moment. How do they know it's the Lamb? They're blinded spiritually because there's only one religion, only one religion in the history of mankind that speaks of the Creator himself coming down to earth, becoming a man, dying on a cross, shedding his blood, giving himself for a lost world, ascending to heaven. And he said, I'm King of kings and Lord of lords. There's only one. Yes. What's his name? Jesus. They know who it is who's delivering this wrath, this judgment. And let me tell you, God deals in mercy now. If we've got a friend or a loved one that's not saved, take a mask, sit down with them, win them to Jesus. You say, but I have to be 6 feet away. Well, at least get 6 feet, sit down on a couch with them. Show them that you love them. Because when the wrath of a lamb is exercised, it's going to be too late. So the third reason for the rapture is to deliver us from the wrath that is to come. And said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us. Revelation 14:10, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the angels and in the presence of the Lamb. One day God's going to say, I've had enough. That's reason number three. Number four, the fourth reason for the rapture is to get us off the scene, to get us out of the way. I mean, God deals with us, his bride, and that's a local church, as we know, where God presents the gospel. Now, of course, every soul that's born, whether they've ever seen a good Bible-believing local church, if they've really trusted the Lord Jesus, they belong to Jesus. But there is a local church where God has a pattern and a program for us to get the full truth. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. But anyhow, to get us all of the redeemed out of the way, because God has a new economy already forecast. You can read it in Daniel chapter 9. Daniel chapter 9. 70 weeks are determined upon thy people and upon thy holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end of sins, and to make reconciliation for iniquity, and to bring in everlasting righteousness, and to seal up the wisdom and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy. This coming Saturday at the museum at 11 o'clock, we have Nadav Melikar. We're going to have all of the Old Testament scrolls from Christian Heritage Foundation all spread out at the museum. A born-again Jewish believer is going to take Daniel chapter 9 and Isaiah chapter 11 and Isaiah chapter 53 and show how those refer exclusively to Jesus Christ. He is the Son of the living God. It's a born-again Jewish believer who will bless your heart. That's at 11 o'clock this coming Saturday morning over at the Creation Evidence Museum. I mention that because he's going to spell out the fact that God has a program that involves Israel. And we've got to get out of the way. So one reason for the rapture is for him to fulfill his commitment to Israel for his kids to come on home. It's supper time. Number five, quickly, to place us in an eternal body. My body's crippled. I don't have any scars from the battles from Satan. Jesus, it's fought all of those for me, and I just love to watch him fight. I just love to watch Satan flee. Just the mention of the name of Jesus. But do you know, we do have a body that's falling apart. Went to see my doctor for my annual Medicare last week. He examined everything, asked me a bunch of questions. I didn't tell him all the aches and pains. I just told him basically my feet hurt a little bit. And he finished, and he said, okay, closed his computer. And he said, you're in good health. I said, you mean for an 83-year-old man? He said, no, for anybody. I said, thank you, I'll take that. Oh, little did he know. If I could, why complain? Nobody's listening. So, but our bodies are falling apart. I look in the mirror and I say, that's not me. Yeah, it is. Falling apart. Okay, here's what the scripture says. Oh, if it's not viable, it's only relatively true, right? It's got to be viable. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 53. For this corruptible, my old stinking dirty body, and yours, this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. So reason number five is to give us an eternal body that's never going to decay. Won't that be nice?
Amen.
And number six. The sixth reason is to give us rewards so we can rule and reign with him. Now, I intended to spend 25 minutes on this, but I'm not going to. My time's just about up. The preacher said 9:30 and you got to go home. No, he didn't. He said, if you preach till 7:30, that's too late. You see, it's at the judgment seat of Christ in heaven that we get our crowns. So we've got to be raptured out of the way to have the judgment seat of Christ and the marriage supper of the Lamb, to come back with Jesus to rule and reign for 1,000 years, right? Now, there are five crowns. I'll just mention to you, and we're not going to get them here. Why not? Why not? Oh, I got to put a volume in 20 seconds. Why don't we get our rewards now? How many of you were won to Christ ultimately by hearing or reading one of the books of the New Testament? Just about everybody here, sure, whether you knew it or not. Do you realize that 13, possibly 14 of those, probably 14, were written by the Apostle Paul? Do you realize that every time a person gets saved from one of those books that he wrote, his reward just increased and increased? You see, their works do follow them. They're not given, even at the end of this physical life, he's still reaping. Now, what's Paul going to do with all of those crowns he's going to get? He's going to strut around to heaven all day and say, look, I'm a foundation, I'm a pillar of the church, and I'm the one who... No, no. Like John the Baptist, he must increase, but I must decrease. Paul said, I'm the vilest of all men. What's he going to do with those crowns? Cast them at the feet of Jesus. What are you going to do with your crowns? Cast them at the feet of Jesus. So at least I need to list those crowns. Number one, there's the crown of rejoicing. That's the soul winner's crown. You'll find that in 1 Thessalonians 2:19. 1 Thessalonians 2:19. The soul winner's crown. There's nothing in the world like the joy of winning a soul to the Lord Jesus. Crown of rejoicing. Number two, there's the crown of righteousness. 2 Timothy 4:18, I fought a good fight, I've finished my course, I've kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, but not to me only, unto all them also that love his appearing. wanting Jesus to come, loving the appearing, longing for the rapture, the crown of righteousness. You can gain that crown. Number three, the incorruptible crown. 1 Corinthians 9:25. That's for keeping your body under subjection. Do you know, we're not spiritually, our state is absolute perfection because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Because, preacher, we're accepted in the beloved. I heard you say that. Brother Payne, I heard you preach that. We're accepted in the beloved. But physically, we got problems. We have to buffet this body. And if the Apostle Paul said, I have to buffet my body and keep it under. So, the incorruptible crown is for those who keep their body in subjection. Number four, the crown of life. That's the crown, James 1:27. And Revelation chapter 2, verse 19, the crown of life for those who are faithful unto death. Literally, literally giving their lives in suffering. Number five, the crown of glory. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 4, that's for having a faithful ministry. Number seven, and I'm finished. Number seven. Seventh reason the rapture is going to happen is so that we can enjoy in our new body a new heaven, a new earth, and eternity by loving Jesus with our heart, mind, soul, body, and strength. How many here tonight love Jesus? And if you raise your hand, you're lying. How many of us love Jesus with all our heart, mind, soul, body, and strength? Lord, I believe. Help thou mine unbelief. Simon, lovest thou me more than these? Lord, you know I like you. He was pretty honest right then, preacher. You know I like you. In this body, we'll never have the full joy. Even though there are moments when we could say, Lord, come right now. I love you more than life. And then the alarm rings and we wake up. But we're going to have a new body. We're going to have a mind like the mind of Christ. We will know as we are known. And we will love, say it with me, the Lord with all our heart, mind, soul, body, and strength. Even so, come. Lord Jesus. Pastor.
I want to go ahead and have an invitation after that message. I don't know how your heart was touched. Let's stand together. And I want to ask our instrumentalists to come down and just let the Lord work on your heart as Brother Eddie's going to be singing a verse of invitation in just a moment here. But listen, if God has touched your heart and you need to come down and use these altars, you do that. If maybe you've never trusted Christ, and we've heard the gospel tonight as he's talked about the death and resurrection of Jesus. Maybe as a Christian, you're really not ready for his coming. 1 John 2:28 talks about those Christians who will be ashamed at his coming. Maybe you'd be ashamed if the Lord comes right now. Why don't you pray and get right with God? Listen, don't let what you have heard just go by the wayside. Jesus is coming, and we need to be ready for it. And I just pray the Lord will work in your heart. Just be in a spirit of prayer during this invitation. Brother Eddie, lead us in verse, please.
Is the fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's face? And
Are there others who need to come as we see these who come to the altar? Maybe God's working in your heart and you're just shoving the Holy Spirit away. Don't do that. Let the Spirit work on you.
Lose all their guilty stains. Lose all their guilty stains. And sinners plunge beneath that flood. Lose all.
Let's have another verse as God continues to work down here at these altars.
The dying thief rejoice to see that fountain in his day. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. Wash all my sins away. And there may I, though vile as he, wash all my sins away.
Let me again say thank you. Thank you for being here tonight. Well, we were blessed tonight, weren't we?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Dr. Ball. Thank you so much. As you know, we have not been taking up offerings since the pandemic. We do have envelopes right in front of you. At every door, there is what Brother Eddie Carroll has named our tithing stations. If you would like to write a check, put some cash in an envelope, if you can even find cash anymore, put it in an envelope, write Dr. Ball on it, write your name on it too. Write Dr. Ball on it, and just put it in one of the tithing stations. If you give online, we will make sure by tomorrow that Dr. Ball's name is on our website, so that it already is. All right, very good. His name is, if you go to our website, calvarycleveland.com, and do give under guest speaker, you click, and there will be a pull-down menu, and his name will be there, and you just click there, because we want to be a blessing to him, because he has been a blessing to us. Thank you, Dr. Ball. We appreciate it. And normally at this time, too, I'd have the guest speaker go by back the door and shake everybody's hand, but we're not doing that anymore either. So,
can I get my mask back?
Oh, yes. And, you know, I appreciate this mask, because, see, this is an even higher authority than the United States of America.
Amen.
This is Texas, you know. So.
Thank you.
But listen, he's not going to be back there shaking hands, but I know he'll be down here, and he'll love if you stand about 6 feet away and thank him, because we have been blessed tonight. Thank you, sir. Well, again, so good to see you. We'll see you back Wednesday night. Wednesday night, we're still going to be in the annex on Wednesday nights, but we're so grateful you have come back. And let's just keep these Sunday nights just continuing to move up and up, and then one day we'll all move up, and we look forward to that. Well, let's go ahead and close in prayer. And again, thank you for being here. I'm going to ask Brother Jonathan Ryback, would you go ahead and close us in prayer, please, sir?
Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you so much for fighting all our battles, Lord. We just thank you for being in our lives. We thank you for your presence. Lord, we thank you for being with us through the good times and through the bad, Lord. We just pray that thank you for the work, your word that is gone forth tonight. May it take root in our hearts, Lord. I just pray that you would be at this great nation, Lord, that you would just, I just pray that you would come back quickly, Lord, and I just pray that you would just give us the boldness to reach out to our lost family members and friends who do not know thee, and bring them to thee, Lord. And we just pray that you would bring us back safely at our next appointed meeting. It's in Christ.